Welcome. Thanks for coming. We'll do a little chat on microservices at FashionTrade and the way we've set everything up, obviously using Docker, hence the Docker meetup. A little bit about me. I mostly worked in software development roles prior to working at FashionTrade. I used to run a big data analytics and a machine learning company. Completely different game. Having a lot of fun nonetheless right now. Also getting back into more software engineering, systems engineering, architecture, and systems design, which is good. On top of that, I'm the proud owner of a 3-character Twitter handle, and I have 18 endorsements for awesomeness on LinkedIn.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Awesome.
So what's FashionTrade? FashionTrade is startup right here at GQ. Originally from Amsterdam, but with some Nordic roots, so to speak, because we have our primary investment coming out of Denmark from a huge fashion conglomerate, bootstrapping FashionTrade right here in Amsterdam as a business-to-business platform for fashion wholesale. So this is basically all of the clothing shops anywhere in the world, ideally, but let's start out with Europe, who want to buy from brands and currently are doing that in some kind of very old-fashioned offline process. We want to bring all of that online. So that means it's basically e-commerce for a fashion business. So we simplify wholesale so you can connect, trade, and grow as both a retailer and a brand in fashion. That's what FashionTrade does, so then what does it look like? Obviously, if it's e-commerce, it looks a lot like e-commerce. Right?
Surprise.
Obviously, there are some subtle and interesting differences between what you would expect from like a B2C e-com shop and what FashionTrade does, in the sense that, first of all, as a buyer on FashionTrade, you're not a consumer, you have to always log in. That means you represent some kind of retail organization and you can buy from a number of selected brands that you actually have connections with. Because it's a marketplace, and it means that you don't only buy from whatever is generally out there, but in the fashion world it's very common to have specific agreements with particular brands that you're actually allowed to buy from them. All of this goes back to the fact that, for example, a brand like G-Star doesn't want to be in the same shop as a brand like Jack and Jill's. They both make jeans, they think about each other, they're in a different segment of the market, they don't want to be in the same store, hence they make agreements with retailers specifically about whether or not they are allowed to buy from them. And as a result, on FashionTrade, you have links or connections with brands as a retailer. And we as a platform will also help you make those connections with unknown brands and vice versa, from the brands to the retailers. And then when you have established a bunch of these connections, then you can buy from those brands, and then from that point on, it again looks a lot like e-com. With some exceptions in the way the entire user experience and the flow works, because if you're buying 100 pairs of jeans, it's a different process than buying one or two. And as such, the UX for that looks a lot different. And also, for that and other reasons, our shop doesn't look a lot like Magento or something. So that's FashionTrade. We started development in June previous year, with first of all just me getting on board, and then afterwards bootstrapping the team, and then from that point on growing towards the team that we need in order to get everything up and running. Still working on that. As a result of that, so far we've managed to bring on a couple of people. We have a team of 8 people now, and we've set up the first basic functionality to be able to actually do the e-com flow. As an example, before we get into the things where Docker actually matters, I'd like to take you a little bit into what happens when, as a brand, you interact with FashionTrade. Usually you use our API, you create a product there, and then from that point on, that product obviously has its own life cycle, in terms of data management within the platform. Product information enters through our brand integration API. The brands will use that to usually link with their ERP systems and product information management systems that they have themselves. Obviously, we perform some validation on that. And then when we receive that information, product information gets merged with what we already have in terms of data that relates to that product. These are typically price lists and stock levels. Because as a brand, it's extremely convenient for you to be able to give us a price list before you give us the actual product information. And all of these things happen async, and we need to be very lenient about what we accept there, because they have generally legacy, right? Your ERP systems. So we're fairly lenient at that, and all of these things, they come in asynchronous, and then obviously afterwards we have to check whether that product is actually complete enough in terms of information to actually put in the shop. Meaning it goes in the search engine, it's available for search, and it's available for the connected retailers to buy from that brand. And then later on, that order information goes all over the place. If you look at that flow, it looks a lot like this. On the brand side, you will have ERP systems and custom integrations. Everything goes to our API. It's called PIM here, which stands for Product Information Management, because that's an often used term for this type of stuff. And then on top of that, the brands will also interact with an API for managing their incoming orders. So the orders that retailers place with that brand. So on the external side, we have a representation for products that looks nothing like we use internally, where everything goes on Kafka. And then when we have that product information coming into different systems on the back or front end, as you like to see, we have even different representations for products when it comes to search, and then also different ones when it comes to managing the orders in the baskets. Internally, we call them baskets. Externally, we never do that, because business-to-business users like to think of them as orders.
What?
Orders.
Orders. Orders. Because a basket is something a consumer has. I'm not religious about terminology. Oh, good. And then obviously on that side, you get closer to user facing. On that side, you get closer to brand facing. Basically, this and the fact that these things are in and of itself all separate domains. The representation of a product for search is a lot different from the representation of a product for the brand integration when it comes straight out of their ERP system. All of this is basically our, you know, our validation for also separating these things into services. Or at least one of them. Because that's at the technical level. But then on top of that, why else, you know, would we go through the trouble of setting up a platform to deal with services using Docker, using Kubernetes, going through all of these hoops? Because we could, I mean, given the functionality that we have right now, we could have quite easily done like a Ruby app monolithic with Postgres. It would have played more. So, the thing is, we are setting up for scale, and we are setting up for a certain scalability. The product and having a platform like this isn't a new idea. Our investors are doing it at a smaller scale as part of companies that already are established in the fashion market, but then just only manage like a small number of brands. We're aiming to expand that to any brand that wants to connect, any retailer that wants to connect. We have a huge network in fashion, sales are going really fast, and we need to hook up a lot of brands and retailers pretty soon. And as a result of that, we also anticipate, you know, lots of feature requests coming out of that, and as a result of that, the needs or the requirement to also scale the team. So we want to separate the business concerns, and also we allow to, you know, we want to allow people to work on different aspects of all of that concurrently. And on top of that, and that's nice, the services separation works well in the log-based data architecture. Log-based meaning whatever comes in through the API isn't going to go directly into search engines and databases for other things, but it always goes through queue first, and whoever consumes from that can, you know, think about its own representation or that service's own representation of that data in order to fulfill a very specific need. And then ideally, this makes for the organizational scalability, usually at the cost of, you know, added complexity. It's easier to do the Ruby thing initially. So, an example of what we do. This is, in fact, the integration API service. It's written in Java, it's external facing, it requires authentication, obviously, because we want to know you are actually a brand and then also which one. It has a health check, because that's required for all services, and also it has some admin endpoint, which is also HTTP. It has a bunch of calls on them, but we don't want those to also go out on the internet, because we will use them in rare circumstances to reset things or give particular things an additional push on Kafka or whatever. So that's what these admin endpoints are for. The service within our setup is always represented by a single GitHub repository, or at least a single Git repository, and we use GitHub for Git. Meaning that there's a nice simple one-on-one relation there. So what defines a service, interesting, is a Docker file. Which is cool because this is a Docker file, right? So this is an example of one of our Docker files. You can see it inherits from Jerry, which is our own image that we have in our own private repository. So the repository URL is Google Docker repository that we use as part of the Google Cloud platform. The more important part of this Docker file, because the fact that you actually run some kind of Java app to start up the service is pretty obvious, I guess, for a Java server. The more important part is right here. And when we look into that, this is all custom. So these are labels that when you create a service within our platform, need to provide within your Docker file in order to make it go somewhere. The nice thing about it, this is all you have to do. So what we specify here is the service will have some kind of identifier. It is in fact a service. It's managed by developers, which is great. I think this is a bit of future proofing that we might not necessarily need, but hey, it's cool. There's a team in there. Soon there might be multiple teams doing different services, then at least we're ready for that. And then whoever got there first gets to be the developers, and everybody else has to be some specialized group of developers. There's a description to it. It has a health endpoint. There's a port for the health check. So you see here the health check port actually goes on the admin interface and not on the normal HTTP interface. And then obviously outside we want this thing to be on 80, and in turn it's actually on 8080. So this is a bunch of metadata that describes the service and also describes the requirements for that service. But it's let's say deployment target agnostic. It doesn't deal with whether it's Marathon or Kubernetes or something else there. It's just that little piece of abstraction there that allows anybody in development to create a service, describe this, and say, this is what I need. So the one more thing you need to do in order to create a service, and that's primarily because we haven't automated this yet, is go in a particular repository and edit a Groovy file that has the Jenkins seed job for all services, also for all libraries and objects. And there we add this one line saying, hey, there's a thing called PIM integration service, and we build it using Maven. That's it. Repo, Docker file, one line in the seed job. That gets you a service. So what happens when you do that? Obviously it builds, so the seed job will create Jenkins jobs for that service to start building, not only for the master branch, but for all of the branches, so that branches get built as well. On the master branch, it will deploy, meaning that the normal pipeline in Jenkins has the prepare and a build and a deploy step, so the deploy step only activates for the master branch and not for the other ones. It will update the routing state, because obviously when you put a service live and you want it to be internet facing, something has to make sure that traffic goes there. Monitoring is normally part of your service, and it will set up scaling like for every other service, meaning that if you deploy it, it will do at least the minimal amount of auto scaling that you can expect from anything. So how does it work on Jenkins? It creates a build pipeline, and then these pipelines do all of the individual steps that are required to get things in there. So if you look at our Jenkins here, you can see for the services, also the services get neatly added to the correct tabs here. If you do want to look for them, usually you could search through this, but you get like to fill your notifications on Slack, and there you click the link, and that takes you to your build, obviously. But here we can say, for example, for well, we're talking about PIM, right? So here you see for this PIM integration service, there's the build for all of these individual branches, and then here's a master build. And there you can see we don't always do this. It doesn't always succeed on master, which is, I think, very much startup life. So I'm happy there. But when it does, it will be deployed to an environment called development. So you can see here that the build is one step in the pipeline. You can go through the logs and all of that. It deploys, in this case, to development, and you get a Slack notification. So all that happens as a result of setting these labels. And then onwards, obviously, we'd be interesting in you know, how does it take it from there. So the Jenkins pipeline will get it all the way up to development. And then what we actually do is we do a manual step, which is basically a parameterized build on Jenkins. You click the link. It starts a new pipeline for doing the push to production, because we currently do not automate that, as we don't have like a full integration test suite, because once again, it's very much startup life. We're in a hurry, we're aware of these things. Some of these things will be there sooner than later, some of these things will take some time. But for now, we expect everybody to be really conscious when they push that link for go to production. What can you say?
Don't be stupid.
As a startup, you don't always have time for everything. So that's the Jenkins part of that. Then obviously the question is, how does this deployment work? Because we started out with a bunch of labels and Docker files, and they don't do anything, right? Because they're just there and they're metadata. It is nice that Docker files at least is one like future-proof feature. So labels are convenient. We have an internal tool, which takes the labels out of the Docker file, and it generates a deployment manifest or descriptor for Kubernetes. And then Jenkins will run that tool against your Docker image. It extracts the labels, generates the manifest for deployment, and then pushes that to the Kubernetes cluster in the target cluster, in the target environment. Yeah, we had some internal debate over whether those things are called a manifest. We don't think it's an official term, but we like it a little better than the YAML thing. So, just so you know, from now on, the things that you push to Kubernetes are called a manifest. It makes it sound so much heavier. You should really love that. So the deploy step in the Jenkins pipeline runs this Metatron script and applies the manifest against the environment. Alfonso Jochen came up with Metatron, but I still like the name. And that's in fact a little it's a Python-based tool that obviously takes the labels and runs them through a Jenkins template to generate that YAML file, and then and then obviously whenever you deploy something, it will have some like target environment specific configuration. For us, that's a, like a bunch of things, right? So we have different MailChimp accounts for production and development, and a couple of other things if you really want to keep separate, and they have API keys and all of that. So all of these things we push into Kubernetes secrets. We have a single, well, not a single, but we have multiple vaults in Ansible, and Ansible just runs every hour automatically. So if you ever change one of the secrets files, then it will get pushed out to whatever environment you changed. So in general, it's nice to run your Ansible labels every hour, so you get confident in making changes to it, and that it never like breaks anything when it runs. So the environment-specific configuration is always going in Kubernetes secrets. And then we have also in this metadata that you can put in the Docker file, you can put specific labels in there that tells the entire build pipeline, I want this particular named secret exposed as this and var in the container. And it will just show up there. And then what usually happens is you do var substitution in the configuration file of the service itself. Convenient, so if you run it locally, you can override it. If you run it on, in an environment, it will pick up the correct value as long as you're metadata. So that's deployment. But then, you know, when you deploy Docker containers to Kubernetes, they're just there as a service, and that doesn't make them outward facing. So how do we go about that? We have something in place for service routing. Meaning that there is a single point of entry that takes all of the requests from outside. There's a reverse proxy to whichever service it needs to go to. So obviously this routing state, so the state of the internal state of the routing proxy changes whenever you do a deployment, whenever you create something new, when you add a new service, when a service becomes unhealthy and all of these things. So this configuration depends a lot on the current state of your Kubernetes cluster. So there are quite a few things you can do there. One very obvious thing is I'll write this little cron job that, you know, looks at that state at the cluster state all the time, and then whenever it finds something, it will update like an HAProxy config somewhere, and then that gets reloaded, and then the HAProxy knows about the service again, and then it does all. We decided very early on not to do that, in spite of the fact that it's quite an investment, right? I mean, we have a lot of functionality to build as well, so why build infrastructure software? Yep, we did, and we built our own routing gateway. So it's a custom-built service router. It's called GateKit. I do know who came up with that name. I still like it though. So GateKit. Is our custom service router for Kubernetes. The routing state, this runtime state, is based on the current state of the Kubernetes cluster. So there's no centrally managed configuration. And I think this is really important for something like this, because if whenever you deploy something, somebody has to go somewhere and edit the file, then you know that gets stale over time. This will always look at what is actually running. And it will know what needs to get routed where, because of once more, all of these labels you have in the Docker file, they become metadata on the Kubernetes service that will be deployed. And there, it queries Kubernetes on a polling thread, and it finds the same metadata again, and as such can update the routing state. Both for path-based routing and DNS prefix-based routing. It can always make things go the right direction. Then it can also keep track of the service health for each individual service and actually stop routing requests there if something becomes unhealthy. So on top of solving this problem for us currently, having something in place there that you manage and control yourself in terms of code, also in terms of deployment and the way it works, is that later on we can use this to do things like A/B testing, online experimentation, different versions of the same service with different models for search or search rankings and these kind of things, and also canary deployments can become something that you can centrally manage in that one piece of software. And also writing a reverse proxy is not that hard. It turned out lucky. But nice. So obviously Methodron and GateKit are currently fairly specific to what we do and the way we work. They are, however, you know, probable candidates for later open sourcing because they're not very specific to what we do as a business, but it's just, you know, infrastructure software. But for now, obviously, to keep us moving faster, we keep everything internal because we can make random changes without missing anybody else. So what does that look like in the bigger picture? Outside traffic comes in through Google's Cloud Load Balancer. That does the SSL termination for us. Then on to GateKit. Currently it does authentication and service routing, which is also nice. So internally, services only have to deal with authorization. meaning that you get the authenticated user presented to you as a couple of specified headers. And Gatekit takes care of actually offloading the authentication, turn that into the correct headers, and then at the surface level, you only have to deal with the authorization, just this user group. The role that I expect, is this brand actually entitled to touch that product? Is this retailer actually entitled to order that product? Those kinds of things are surface level responsibilities, which is figuring out who is this person and what organization does this person belong to, is all solved in Gitkit. And then Gitkit, in turn, integrates with an authentication provider. I think this is the logo for Auth0, and we don't actually use that. We use Stormpath now. But anyway, it's an external authentication provider that deals with username and password storage. You should be able to do also things like password resets with emails. Other things that we don't have to build right now. We haven't actually tested them. Maybe. So internally, traffic is routed and then they're already authenticated. If you specify in your service metadata that you need authenticated traffic, meaning that obviously you can also create a service that doesn't have the authenticated flag on it. And we primarily use this for a login page, which I think makes sense. So there's the services. This is where all the APIs are, also the front-end facing APIs, but also anything on the brand facing side. Services are all stateless. Meaning we use external persistent services. Currently, what we have there is Elasticsearch, Kafka, and Google's Cloud Data Store, which is a NoSQL data store. It works for us, and it saves us from having to manage something like Cassandra ourselves. Then what you see here is what we call the control environment. That's where Jenkins is. We have the different repositories for containers, but also for library artifacts and these kinds of things. Wherever we can, we use hosted services. Also, for example, for Java library artifacts, we use a hosted artifactory. We use hosted container registry from Google. The thing we run ourselves is Jenkins, and Jenkins once more runs on the Kubernetes cluster in a separate network environment within the same Google Cloud project. So that's overall what it looks like. So basically what we did here is we created an abstraction over deployment. we didn't say we're going to set up Kubernetes and then everybody who writes services is responsible for pushing the right manifest there. Instead, we say, no, there's an abstraction over deployment that basically allows you as a service, as a developer on the team, to create services and specify, this is where I want it to be, if you look from the outside. And this is the Docker container that I need to run it. And that's all. So one question that arose from that is, is that DevOps? Does that really put the responsibility for maintaining the service in production with the team that developed it? And obviously, to an extent, not really, because somebody else is maintaining this entire pipeline and the abstraction. But on the other side, it does, because you still look at your own production logging, and you still look at your own production data store when things actually go wrong. The benefit of the abstraction is that whenever somebody new starts on the team, I can explain that person these labels in the Docker file in 25 minutes. So, starting, creating a first service, getting it into a deployment, first in development, then in production, is something that's really easily feasible in the first day of working at FashionTrade. And then, the cost factor in that is, if something really goes wrong underneath the abstractions, then you need somebody else to look at it. And then over time, more and more people do a deep dive in the stack and also in all the solutions that are around it. So more and more people will learn it at some point. But if you make everybody from their first day on responsible for everything that is in the production system that touches their particular service, then organizationally, it's hard to scale that. How do you hire 5 people in a single month and get them all up to speed that quickly on everything you do so they can do this. So I think there's always a trade-off between the complete understanding of all of the moving parts and the speed or velocity with which you can onboard new people on your team. And if you're not willing to consciously think about that trade-off, then you're probably going with one of the two religions and get lost in blindly following that. So I think it's good to be conscious of that trade-off. So what are monitoring? Most monitoring systems are pool-based. Right? You deploy an agent somewhere and then you configure the agent, go to that JVM and extract these JMX metrics, go to that particular other service and grab the syslog from it, I don't know what, and then you have this monitoring agent with a bunch of configuration, and then that monitoring agent will push most of your metric data up to some kind of time series data store. It's roughly all of them work. So the primary issue with that for services deployments and also these very dynamic landscapes is the pool-based part of that. Because whenever you deploy a new service, whenever you add a new thing, you have to change the configuration of the monitoring agent. So it's much nicer to have services push out metrics to the monitoring agent. We're currently experimenting with something called Datadog, which is a SaaS-based service, a hosted service. But they do have an agent that allows for push. It means that whenever you introduce a new thing into your stack, you create a new service, you have to do a little bit of effort for making sure that that service can actually push to the agent. But as a result of that, you don't have to do anything special on deployment of a service. Because if something new surfaces, it will just be there and start pushing out metrics, instead of having to reconfigure an agent or a collection agent somewhere. So that's what's happening there. We're still learning with it. We've only actually been toying with it for about a week or so now. This is the way it's set up. And this is an artist's impression. Left side. I'd be happy to introduce you to the artist later. It's not me. So, Datadog on the on the server side, it's a SaaS-based solution. It's just there. It's pretty much what you expect. It's a UI that's a web UI that's made for creating dashboards that allows you to create dashboards slowly and painfully. However, when you have them, you have them. And then on top of that, you can set alerts, and these alerts integrate again with anything you'd expect, ranging from Slack to PagerDuty to wake you up in the middle of the night. So the way it's deployed on our cluster is it's set up as a daemon set. Daemon set is a Kubernetes feature that will basically fire a particular container, making sure that there is exactly one instance on each of the hosts on the cluster, or each of the nodes, whether physical or virtual machines or something else. You get one instance of the daemon set container on each node, and then from there on it just has a service name just like anything else. So there's the containers that run as part of the pod that are part of the service, and then the service just routes to whichever one is closest usually. And then our services will talk to the Datadog collector daemon, for which because it wasn't there yet, we have decided that this is the official logo. We thought it was a good machine. Logging is obviously also a concern. So the Google Cloud platform comes with this, I was going to say integrated, but it's really not integrated. It comes with a solution for logging and monitoring and alerting and all of these things. It's called Stackdriver. It's an acquisition by Google, and it looks like a lot like an acquisition that's having a hard time fitting in with the new family. So we had a poor out-of-the-box experience there. You can see your logs, and that's about it. And it does the infinite scroll, and then, yeah, that's it. And all of your stack traces are one log entry per line, and all kinds of other things that make it less than ideally useful when things actually go wrong. So we're moving to Elk. I think many people in the end move to Elk. I want to postpone that by a lot, because managing Elk means you're managing Elk. And then, interestingly, what always happens is when everything goes wrong beyond your worst dreams, then Elk isn't working either if you did it yourself. We're setting up now our login on logs.io, which is hosted Elk. Not saying that we're not as good as them in running Elk, but I'm saying if there's two independent parties running Elk, then there's a lesser probability of them failing at the same time. Because obviously we do run Elasticsearch because we have search. We don't run Kibana on that, but we have our own front end. And always Kibana is the least of your problems. A word on dependencies, because this always triggers people when you do the services dance. And how does it work? Because you get all these dependencies and things are always tied to each other. And isn't it really just a monolith chopped up in pieces? So this is a really involved dependency diagram because it doesn't only list the services but also the infrastructure services, and you can't even see the lines because they're in some kind of light gray color. But this is the infrastructure stuff, so this is also like the cloud platform and Zookeeper and Kafka and Elasticsearch, and all these things are in here, plus the services, plus the individual user-facing functionalities. So you have functionalities that depend on services for being healthy, right? So if for example, let's say, this is one thing here, if this dies, then there's a lot of functionalities that don't work. And they all have to do with orgs, because that's the order service. It makes sense. So that's why there's a lot of lines here, because the functionalities are in there as well. These aren't all services. But that said, there are still lines between the services. Some of them are blue, some of them are red. The blue ones are asynchronous, that means they go over Kafka. The red ones are synchronous, that means they go by the direct HTTP call from one service to another. And then it is sometimes said to me and others by people that whenever you do that, whenever you have these synchronous calls, then they say, yeah, that's just expensive method calls, so your thing is actually a monolith. I dare to debate that because it's not about sync versus async. It really doesn't matter. Because if a synchronous HTTP call is an expensive method call, then an asynchronous one is really expensive, right? Because it takes a lot longer. So no, it really isn't about that. It's about schemas and it's about evolution. And being evolution friendly with your schemas. So what does that mean? It means that if I make a call to a service and that service gives me something back, then that payload adheres to a particular schema. And sometimes the producer of that data wants to change something. And the producer of that service needs to be able to independently do so. So on the producing side of that piece of data, the service can add a field, but that field has to always be optional. Because if I read with an old schema, then I want to be able to discard it. But then also, if somebody produces with an old schema, but I read with a new schema, it has to be optional because it's not there if somebody is writing with the old schema, right? And then obviously, on the reading side, you have to deal with the absence of optional values. Usually this is by setting some kind of default value, and sometimes it's also by doing different types of logic based on what is there. But this is really what it's about. If you don't do the schema evolution on the entities, then obviously the two different services are tightly coupled. And it doesn't matter at that point whether you get the entity over a synchronous call or an asynchronous call. Because it's something that comes off a queue, it's something that comes in over an HTTP call. But in the end, it's something you cannot read. And that's what creates the tight coupling. And that's where schema evolution comes in. And currently, this is hard. It's hard for everybody, it's hard for us too, because you never focus on it in the beginning. I think I have that later on the slides as well. We'll get to it. But this is the true concern of keeping services decoupled, but they still have to work together to achieve something, right? Whenever we put a product in the API, it goes on Kafka, and the search service has to deal with that product in order to get it into the search engine. If at some point we start producing stuff on Kafka that search doesn't understand anymore, then it's broken. That's schema evolution. Just a little aside on the diagram, we don't actually draw that. it's a YAML file that has all the dependencies and then a little tool that generates PDF. So here's some random experiences. We don't manage our own Kubernetes cluster, we run it in Google Cloud. It's a Google container engine. You can say, I want this many things, and it will spin them for you, and it will have Kubernetes. And then whenever there's a new version of Kubernetes, you can press a button, and then it gets upgraded in a rolling upgrade, and that's pretty nice. The upgrades are very smooth. We haven't had any real problems there. We have some other issues though. But first, the good news, the ingress is really nice. So Kubernetes has the concept of ingress. When you create an ingress, it's tied to an ingress controller, and the ingress controller basically determines how really external traffic entering your cluster is going to get to your particular service. So when a service needs to be really, really public facing, and in our case, the only one that actually needs that is the gateway service, because everything else goes through there. But you can set, once more, a label in the Docker file that says this thing is outside facing, and then the manifest has the ingress in there as well that gets generated, and then you get an ingress. And on Google Container Engine, if you create the default ingress, then it becomes a Google Cloud load balancer. Just out of nowhere, it's just there. And it provisions all of that. And you have to supply the name of a Kubernetes secret that holds the TLS certificate for your SSL termination. And then it gets an IP. And the nice thing about the IP is that even stays static. If you delete and destroy entire service and you create it again, and it has the same name, then it kind of figures, yeah, it's probably the same thing. I'll give you the same IP because your DNS settings will probably match up. And that's nice because, Google's Cloud Load Balancer isn't DNS-based, it's BGP-based, as it should be, because the DNS-based is, that's just the wrong thing to do. There's stillness and different kinds of latency interactions. Don't try to do really heavy things with ELBs on that. So Google's Load Balancer are IP-based, so you keep the same IP and it's a static DNS setting. We don't even automate it because it's just always the same thing anyway. One thing that really surprised me is at some point we changed the certificate. So I just changed the secret in the vault actually, and then the Ansible jobs will at some point give a kick to the cluster by rerunning it, and then you get a new secret value in the Kubernetes cluster for that particular name. And automatically the GKE Kubernetes reconfigured the cloud load balancer with the new TLS certificates. That just happened. So that was a pleasant surprise, I have to say. I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting to have to manually at least, you know, trigger the recreation of the ingress or something, but it just worked. Autoscaling sometimes doesn't, which is annoying. Because it's autoscaling, because when it should do, and not. So there's two levels of autoscaling. So there's pod autoscaling in Kubernetes, which just spins more containers at the same time for a service. That's HPA's, horizontal pod autoscaling. And then there's node autoscaling, which is the Google service. The nodes in the Kubernetes cluster are part of an instance group. And at the instance group level, you say if there's so much GPU for this thing, then start spinning new nodes. And that's where it goes wrong, because sometimes when we have CPU bursts, then one of the nodes actually goes into some kind of state where it can't be reached anymore. And then the node autoscaling stops working. So you used to have like five nodes, and then one of them becomes unresponsive, and then you have four, and it doesn't want to create number six.
What are your instances?
I actually don't know. And also we have different ones for different environments. But yeah, they're fairly light right now. That should ideally be a separate concern. Right? Should be able to just put the number very high. Yeah. So one of the lines of thought is obviously that if you don't constrain the pod itself properly, and you allow it to allocate too much memory, for example, then it actually influences the host, and then things go right there. But even if the host goes bad because of that reason, autoscaling would mean autoscaling, right? So it should add nodes at the very least. If one is dead, then please make a new one. So we're still looking into this. And obviously, we're kind of hoping that many people are looking into it and it will go away over time. But no, it's definitely there on our own backlog as well. The other hard thing we talked about is the schema discipline. You always start out with JSON because it's a simple thing to do. Everybody understands it. There's very little learning curve. You always should start out with a better defined binary format, also over Kafka and actually also over RPC calls as well. We didn't, nobody does. We are in the process of, at least right now, making sure that the JSON-based things that we do, where the schema is defined in code, that code is actually used as only a schema and nothing else. Because obviously when you have a schema in code, then it attracts logic as well, right? So you have this thing that defines all the fields that are in there, but I can really just add this one little method that is only a currency conversion. No. So right now, as a result of that, it gets really easy to publish evolutionary compatible schema data on your channels, whether it's an RPC or a message on Kafka. I do have to say that gRPC looks promising. For those of you who don't know it, it's an RPC framework by Google. It uses HTTP2 as transport, but it uses protobuf for RPC and schema definitions. So you have schema definitions for the entities, and you have protobuf RPC definitions for the actual endpoints. And protobuf was built with schema definition in mind again. So schema discipline is hard. We messed it up a couple of times, back then not much of a problem. It's becoming more and more of a problem right now because actual users are going to come on the platform soon. It's unfortunate to have to throw away data just because schema. Some other observations, and I think that's kind of important, right? Because we started this entire dance with the abstraction over the service deployment and doing the services in the first place, and making it super easy to get software to production, to actually make sure it happens a lot. As a result of doing services, you're likely to see your Git repos over time grow. So we've been at it for about 6 months. We went from something to, I think, 48 right now. So it's natural. Git repos are cheap. Services are supposed to be cheap, so it doesn't matter if you create a lot. Then if the team grows, you should also expect to see this kind of curve in the commit volume, more or less. The number of commits doesn't always equate useful stuff built, but it's something, right? Obviously, things get a little bit slower at the end of the year because it's Christmas. And then this is the same thing, but then cumulative, and then not so much. It's separated out by team member. I never have a legend on this because it's not about the individual team members, but what's more important is whenever you see a new color appear, that means somebody started at that point, right? So that means that here somebody started, and you can see that the ramp up for somebody who started here is not that different from somebody who started here. No, that means that for somebody who does that going that way and this showing kind of the same spread means that it shouldn't matter that much whether you join here or here or here or here. The increase of productivity over time, at least in terms of commits, it's kind of the same. So this is like a back of a napkin validation that using this entire setup with the service actually pays off in some way. That obviously we push really hard for having everybody do their first production commit on day two. It's a good story as well. I did the same graphs so this is not commits, but this is merge pull request, which translates into production deployments. At least it did then, because we only used one cluster at that time, to see how often we would break it. In the beginning, quite a lot, the test. It calls here software updates over time, because I used this for the investor. It's pull requests, merge pull requests. This is the same, but then by week. And the colors here are not people, of course, but they're repositories or services. So you can see some services are busier than others. And then we do all this with an active team size of, at the height of our company, it looks like 12, and now it's 11, now it's 10 again. That's the contractor story here. So this is the number of people that have actually made commits in that week. This is really hard to, well, this is a very long explanation. I'm not going to go. So those were some lessons learned, some key observations, and now obviously I have to find a thing. I mean, you got it right. I'm paying for lots of your views here. So, backend engineers, JVM, Python for core platform customer success roles, front-end engineer. The front-end that you saw is plain JavaScript, React and Redux. And we're looking for somebody who can take ownership of the entire platform that I just showed you, including Google Cloud setup and the deployment delivery pipeline. Do we have time for questions, Jason?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Oh, many. Oh. Yeah.
You had an API gateway in one of your diagrams. What is your API gateway?
So it's custom software, as I explained, because it takes care of the routing state and everything. It's written in Java. It's written on top of an HTTP implementation called Undertow. Undertow comes out of JBoss/Red Hat. Which is the low-level HTTP implementation that also underpins their app service products, like JBoss and whatever they're called now.
Why did you write it instead of using something existing?
So we wrote it because right now we can have it consistently keep track of the cluster state and use that for routing state. And it gives us full control over that process instead of having to write some kind of job that interprets cluster state and translates that into a configuration for something that exists. And I know there are existing API gateway kind of products, many of them, and also the cloud providers have some of their own. That's a little bit of future proofing that I did myself, because I know down the line you want to do A/B testing, you want to do experimentation, and you want to do data collection with that in mind. And that's a really hard problem. And I used to do that for a living.
Yeah. I have more questions, but I'll stop here.
Yeah. Niels.
Yeah. The labels on the Docker are nice. You can express a lot in them. There's also a lot of labels. So I was wondering, how would you, with that in mind, about the JSON schemas you were talking about? Is it schematized? Is it validated? Can you upgrade the version of it?
Currently, no. So the nice thing about versioning is, for the first one, you don't have to do anything special.
If there's no version, it's the first one.
Exactly.
Right.
The validation happens on deploy time, obviously, because if we don't generate a proper manifest from it, then it doesn't work. If we generate a proper manifest from it, but it doesn't do as expected, then obviously you messed it up. We're currently, as a team, I think, not large enough to put like more stricter control on whether or not you can mess it up.
Is there a tool that you use to at least validate that it works now, or is it like you press a button and it won't deploy?
You press a button and it won't deploy. The build will fail. Obviously, we get the notification of the failed builds and these kinds of things. But other than that, it won't deploy. But that's more on the DevOps side, right? You created it, you want to deploy it, it doesn't work. No, go figure or ask somebody.
So you're defining
the track of the service, like you introduce new service and how do you track of what I'm not using anymore?
But it's like the huge dependency diagram with all the lines.
Yeah.
I personally take care of editing the YAML file to reflect the current state every once a week or once in 2 weeks.
Okay. Do you follow like the usage of each service or an analytics on each one of them?
There's no automated process there at this point. So I actually edit the YAML file to say, hey, we created this service last week. I know about it now, I put it in a file. I look at the dependencies that it has and then it draws a new diagram for us.
Yeah, but do you know if it's actually use call or like load on it or?
Right, so obviously the service has metrics that go into this data log thing, right? So yeah, if somebody's reluctant to actually put the little metrics configuration snippet in their service, yeah, then we could actually never know about it. But normally, you put the metrics in there, yeah, and then we see things like how many 2xx, 3xx, 4xx, 5xx response calls did it do, and these kind of things.
All right.
Yeah. So since you're starting to build a product which is cloud agnostic, right? Not to be tied to some specific cloud system. I mean that with this kind of problems with Google Cloud, you try to consider to move to any other cloud system which won't have the scaling issues.
No, but also we're really not trying to be cloud agnostic. So, for example, we rely strictly on Google's Cloud Data Store. It's the primary authoritative persistence that we use, and it's one of their hosted solutions. We don't put any abstraction to enable us to get away from that.
Because I thought this labeling was done in terms of
The abstraction is not so much to abstract away the cloud provider, but the abstraction is to abstract away the deployment mechanism from the people writing the services in order to be able to manage that either at some point in the future from a separate team or at the very least right now to allow people to use it before they get to know it internally, which speeds up initial development.
Considered using the GitHub organization plugin for Jenkins to automatically build your stuff?
I personally haven't. I know a guy who owns a Jenkins t-shirt in our team for particular reasons, not to be spoken of. Have we considered that, Peter?
What's the question?
Have we considered using a Jenkins organization plugin to automatically do things?
No.
It sounds as a no. But I'm happy to talk in a bit about what that would benefit us and what the caveats are. And then later on, doing that sped up by at least 3 weeks because you told me important things about it.
Any more questions?
I think there is.
How do you do integration testing? Do you use something like Composer for that at all?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, right now we push to production manually and we don't dare to do it automatically yet because we don't have enough integration testing in place. We're currently, as we speak, working on getting at least a couple of Selenium plus API scenarios in place that will do the dance. So that's the start of it. And we'll run those against both development and production environment continuously and obviously on as part of the pipeline before the production deploy later on. We have to build up some confidence in it.
Yeah. About your own router, routing component that you did.
Yeah.
There are so many open source registration, discovery, routing questions.
Yeah. When there is a single particular problem, and there is 500 things doing it, how general do you think the problem is? So there are so many open source solutions to this, and all of them do something, just slightly differently. So we looked at many of them. The only real alternative to what we did, in our opinion, was to go the HA proxy way and write something that dynamically configures it. Because most of these things out there are, they're in many cases like code dumps from people who want to be open source. It wasn't generic enough to customize it to what we needed, and it wasn't doing exactly what we needed either. And then obviously we missed exactly the one that did. That's always the case.
Go to the open source.
I was going to say we can get into a discussion about you joining and then making it your pet peeve. there is no policy or otherwise organizational friction against it. So,
but it will be 5 more than 1.
Huh?
It will be 501 solutions.
Then it would be 501. So if that's the case, if it would be code dump, then I don't care too much for it. Yeah, that was the final question.
Yeah, so I'm wondering what kind of messages are you using Kafka and then you do on the direct synchronous call?
Usually you start out with the synchronous call, you make your piece of functionality work, and then afterwards you change it into just listening on the topic and building up your own state local to that service, because then at least you get to store it the way you exactly use it within your own service. So that's roughly it. There were some services that didn't for entities that got created. We're during this sprint making sure that all services push all entities they create down Kafka. Also for the sake of having a single thing for internal usage that allows us to search for anything, which is really handy. Because that would just, you know, list on all topics and index it in Elastic. Cool, thank you.